Brother Roger, thank you for the interview as always. Mm-hmm. And you know my great love of Therese. Now, what I find beautiful about her is she dies at age 24, towards the end of the 19th century.
Right.
She is known only among her sisters, is not necessarily this giant popular figure in France yet. And yet within a decade of her death, miracles are attributed to her. Her autobiography, The Story of a Soul, is published in hundreds and hundreds of copies, thousands. And ultimately, Pope Pius X, I believe, is the one who opens the cause for canonization, mm-hmm. right? So we're left with a figure of enormous gravitas, and yet we know her as the little flower.
Right.
So what would you say was one of the contributing factors in making this young nun into a doctor of the church?
Well, again, she always was the little way. She wanted to leave a hidden life. And when she entered Carmel, again, in her early life, she was traumatized by the death of her mother, who died very young at 45 of cancer. And she was very traumatized her early years. And when she entered the Carmelite monastery or convent, she basically was very traumatized. She cried very easily. She was very scrupulous. And she was very difficult to blend in. And she came to terms with that a few years later, saying that she learned her spirituality of doing the little things, saying that for her to get to heaven, it's the little things that we do and not the big things. She wanted to live a hidden life. Now, you were referring to her autobiography. Her sister, one of her blood sisters, she gave her permission to audit or to change some of the writings better for publications of that book. But she wanted a hidden life. She had no idea that her book would be published and that her inner journeys would be published to the public. But it was her little ways, her simple ways, that she explained as being little rose petals that would be sprinkled along the way. And at times she considered herself like a little grain of sand, that the lighter she became, the easier it was for God to lift her up to heaven. She didn't want to have anything heavy associated with her. She wanted to do her life in a very simple, unattracted way. It wasn't just being kind to another sister, or a gesture, a word of thanks, a smile, a gesture, especially to those who were giving her a hard time. Some of the sisters gave her a hard time. She wasn't very good with arts and crafts in their crafts as nuns doing lace work and so forth. So one of the sisters always picked on her. But all the more, she loved that sister even more because she gave her a hard time.
And there was an elderly sister, Sister Peter, right, who was, very, we would say, maybe ratchety in some sense.
Yeah, yeah.
And, you know, she was
yeah.
always complaining and bitter.
Right.
Aren't you too young? Because one of the great, great novelties about Therese is she went to Pope Leo XIII as a 15-year-old girl
right.
to request
that she
to enter
the convent.
Carmel.
Right.
And that tells you something about the tenacity of this.
Right. When she did, and she would not let go of the Pope, that the Vatican gods had to come to her and pull her off the Pope, because he just said, leave it in God's hands. You know, trust in God. If this is God's will, it will happen. But she wouldn't let go of the Pope, and she was just frantic. That's where I believe she put her hair up to make herself look older, and she really wanted the Pope to intercede. Yeah.
One of those really hilarious moments, too, in a very sweet and sacred way, is obviously, I remember her first plea was, you know, Father, permit me to enter Carmel at the age of 15. I think his answer was, oh, listen to your superiors, right? And then, you know, you would expect that to be it, to be the end of the discussion. But she presses on. She says, Holy Father, if you permit this, mm-hmm. everyone will have to agree. Mm-hmm. Her little way is emphasizing that the childlike, almost boldness in, mm-hmm. in some aspect.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. But her early years were very traumatic. It was only in the Carmel that she came to terms with herself in what she called the conversion, that she, in an instance, went from a childhood approach to life to an adult. And she blessed God for allowing her to do things in very simple, very unimportant. She wanted to be hidden. She didn't want her life to be publicized. She was always hiding as a young child. She was bullied in school as a young girl because she was very smart. So one girl always bullied her. When she entered the convent, she had the same situation where some of the nuns gave her a hard time because they felt she was being favored because she had a number of other sisters in the convent, and one of them became the abbess of it. And so there was some jealousy from the other sisters, but she used her little ways of augmenting, you know, what was being done. And she just continued to bless and to do little things for these sisters who would, if they were washing clothes, the sister would purposely throw water and suds in her ways just to aggravate her. And she would just smile in her own little way and, you know, consider it a blessing. So, you know, and pray for those who insult you.
Which I personally love, because here you see her always smiling. And I think, you know, a lot of critics will say, oh, isn't she very saccharine, very sweet? But her way is very hard, mm-hmm. because it literally requires taking the little annoyances of everyday life, or the great annoyances and great mm-hmm. burdens, and facing them with that same tranquil smile we see in the wood carving. Right. You look into her eyes and you say, oh, how serene. But it really is a sereneness born through battle. And that's why in other carvings of her, we see her with the flowers and the cross, mm-hmm. almost to suggest, you know, you can find this sense of security, but only by denying oneself, taking up one's cross, and following mm-hmm. Christ.
Yes.
And it's that sense of living the passion in our ordinary, everyday acts of charity and of humility and of kindness that really struck me. There was that one moment when she was a little girl, where, as you were saying, she was suffering from all these torments. Uh-huh. And there was that statue of the Virgin Mary in her bedroom.
Right, that smiled at her.
And that was grace in that smile that overcomes her.
Right.
It reminded me of Augustine a little bit.
Well, she told the sisters about this, the other sisters, and they kept questioning her so much to a point that she was wondering whether she actually did see that, because she was filled with such scrupulosity and the sisters, she started to question, did I really have that experience? Because the sisters constantly questioned her, saying, does this really happen? She came to a point where she wasn't sure if it did happen.
And in a similar way, towards the end of her life, you know, the Lord gave her the experience of one who did not have hope in heaven, right. which I thought was really right. interesting. The mm-hmm. idea that here's a saint to the church, mm-hmm. but even she experiences doubt of the existence of paradise at one moment, mm-hmm. which, you know, for me, in looking at the Dark Night of the Soul, because she was a great lover of St. John of the Cross,
right.
it seemed like the fulfillment of this
right.
lived out more perfectly.
Right. Well, the thing is, there was a priest who came to preach, and his was, in a sense, more of fire and brimstone, and that's when she began to question, saying, did heaven really exist? A short time later, a Franciscan priest came, and he preached about the mercy of God and that God's love was always there. And so all of her doubts and questions that she had, saying, does heaven really exist? She came to believe from this other preacher who came that he preached in a sense of love and compassion and understanding from God. And so that changed her whole approach and her fear that, you know, was she ever going to get to heaven? So her faith in does heaven exist did exist because this other priest came and preached in a different fashion at that time of God's love and compassion.
And what I find remarkable about that as well is her willingness always to listen. It seems like she always had one ear to hearing everyone else's perspective on the gospel. Mm-hmm. And she was commanded to write a story of a soul, I believe. Manuscript A just covers her childhood. Mm-hmm. Manuscript B, her entry into the convent. And then while she's dying of tuberculosis, she's writing Manuscript C. So, like, you know, it isn't like, as you're saying, she's looking for publicity in the limelight.
No.
You know, neither is she this kind of character who's wanting to be up there on the pulpit. Her sweet simplicity, and yet at the same time wrestling mm-hmm. with so many anxieties and questions,
right.
Is what really attracted me to her.
Yeah, her life since her mother's death and into the convent, those were traumatic years that most people didn't realize how difficult it was for her just to deal with people. I mean, her sisters left the house and went to the convents. Her mother died. She felt abandoned. She felt isolated. And yet, when she entered Carmel, even though her sisters were there, she knew that she wasn't going to enter the convent so she could be with her sisters, but she was there because she had a mission that God wanted her to fulfill.
And another aspect, too, of course, is her her childhood and her parents. Now, as we were discussing earlier, Zaylee and Louis Martin are the first canonized couple.
Right.
I mean, let's discuss that. That is a remarkable home for a young woman to grow up in.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. They were both. They were, had both considered religious life before they got married. They were both, he was going to become a canon, and she was going to enter the convent and work with the sick and the poor. And it was one of their spiritual directors who said, no, you're called to marriage. So they did have 9 children. 3 died in infancy, and 1 little girl, I think Helene or Helen, died when she was about maybe 5 or 6. And it was difficult for the father because all he had left was his daughters, and each daughter was going into the convent. And so it was very difficult for him to let go of his daughters because that's all that he had.
One of the most tender moments in the story of his soul I've been experiencing is when he calls his daughter my little queen.
Right.
And she calls him, my little king.
Right.
And when you think of that kind of warmth and intimacy, how much of a loss must have been experienced Louis's losing his wife, he's losing all of his daughters one by one, and yet I don't see him complaining in the text, which is remarkable.
No, but it was difficult because he basically, when Teresa asked to enter the Carmel, he said no to her initially, and saying there are already enough sisters in the convent. And in one of the films on her life, you could see him very patiently, he had his hands under the table, and he was kind of putting his nails into the wood of the table, because he knew how difficult it was to let go of her. And that's when she went to Rome and spoke to the Pope. And finally, he relented and said, you can enter the convent.
And another interesting thing for me is when I read Zaylee's comments when Therese is a little girl, because she was very sickly when she was born, right?
Yes, she was very sick. She had to be given over to a nurse. So that because she was very, very weak as a child, they thought they would lose her. So she went to live with this woman for a number of months to regain her strength and return to health before she could return to the family.
And
you have to realize her mother had the breast cancer, so for her, as a young baby, to be fed and everything by the mother was impossible. So they gave her over to this woman who nursed her.
And another interesting image which always comes to mind, and this is, I think, in the film version of her life, which was from the 50s, is her listening to the stories of the saints growing up.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, both of her parents were, considering religious life. They had a Josephite celibate marriage for 9 months before they gave that up. And so you could see where her heroes were. And it was this wonderful scene where she's listening to the life of Saint Joan of Arc.
Mm-hmm.
And she says, I want to be like Joan of Arc.
Mm-hmm.
And yet, how does she live the life of a martyr? She doesn't have what you would call wet martyrdom. With blood, it's almost like a dry martyrdom, but no less, fraught with spiritual warfare. I mean, the toe-to-toe with the devil that she must have had is extraordinary, but it's done always with a sense of trust.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm always reminded in the New Testament, the word Christ uses for the Heavenly Father is Abba, which, of course, could almost be translated some ways to Papa. And she has that same kind of warm, soft perspective of the Heavenly Father, which I thought was rather, rather fascinating for me. Well, we know that Therese is a doctor of the church.
Correct.
And I was just going to ask you, for you and your own experience, we see John Paul II naming her a doctor. She talks a lot about vocation at one point. She says she wanted to be both a prophet, a priest, martyr, missionary, and ironically doctor at one point. But she claims that she can be none of these except by love. The love for her is a way of living out every single vocare, every single vocation. Can we speak to that as the concluding note of Saint Therese's theology?
Right. Well, her theology was very, very simple. It was kind of a hidden journey between her and God. But any vocation is not just about you. It's about other people in the church. And so she was known to be praying for priests and their missions in the Africa and other countries, and the struggles that the priests were going through. So her vocation was that she was doing sacrifices and penance, not for herself, not for self-gratification, but she was doing it primarily to help the priests who were struggling in their vocations to bring the gospel to the other churches in Africa and other countries. And so she's also the patron saint of gardeners. She's the patron saint that priests would turn to for her prayers and her intercession to help them, because they were in foreign countries. They were living very difficult lives preaching the Gospels, and Therese, by her little ways, they felt that her strength and her prayers were helping them in their vocation.
And in that same sense, we are sort of missionaries as the lady as well, and right. I think that we're almost a missionary country in reverse sometimes. Mm-hmm. I find Therese is helpful for me in the new evangelization.
Right.
Do you think it was John Paul II's emphasis on the new evangelization that led to his interest in Therese? What do you think sparked it?
Well, I think he always had a great love for St. Therese, but it was her simple ways that, again, the church is always in very difficult times.
Oh, yeah.
And that her prayers, even though she stayed within the cloister of her convent, had a way of reaching out through her sacrifice and her prayers and offering her communions, that she was helping priests in more ways than she realized. A lot of the Russian Orthodox faith, when I did a course at St. Vladimir's here in Yonkers, Father Hopko, who was giving the lectures on prayer, said, the Catholic Church has no idea the importance that St. Teresa and her little ways are helping the church, even from within her walls. So it's the little ways that help people deal with their vocations, in whatever vocations, priesthood, missionary, martyrdom. So it was her very life of sacrifice was helping them in their way of strengthening them in their missions.
Well, once more, brother, as always, thank you, as always.
You're very
welcome. And another successful, glorious interview.
Very good.